Again, welcome to Knowledge 5, The War of 1812. Today, we're going to be talking about the read-aloud titled Broad Stripes and Bright Stars. Probably recognize those words, and we'll talk more about that here soon. Before we do, let's talk about our vocab words for this, our War of 1812 vocab. I will read the word. You repeat it after me. Represent. Patience. Magnificent, economy, quench. And as a review, the British attacked the Washington, D.C., and didn't go so well. They burned down a lot of the buildings. Luckily, though, Dolly Madison and everyone else was safe. And Dolly Madison also saved some important papers and a portrait of George Washington. After the British attacked Washington, D.C., they turned their eyes towards Baltimore. Now, also, we need some essential background knowledge, and we're going to be hearing about those words are from our national anthem. A national anthem is like a patriotic song and is sung to show that people are proud of their country. What is the name of our national anthem? It's titled The Star-Spangled Banner. What are some events when they might sing the national anthem? At sporting events are the big ones that we hear it. But then there's others like the 4th of July or even some other school events. In today's Read Aloud, you will learn about when and why the Star-Spangled Banner was written. And you're going to be able to, after today's Read Aloud, be able to explain the origins of the Star-Spangled Banner and show an understanding of the word inspired. What happened after the British left Washington? Asked Adele. As you can imagine, Grandfather Lafitte replied, the British were feeling very confident. They defeated the U.S. Army in Washington and destroyed the Capitol. They planned to capture Baltimore next. And at that time, it was a very important port. What is a port? Asked Adele. A port is a town or city where ships stop and unload cargo. Baltimore was a deep water port, meaning that the water was deep enough for really big ships to sail in and dock there. Baltimore was a port where ships could send their and receive goods such as flour, tobacco, and sugar. Besides that, Baltimore is a central location between New York and Philadelphia to the north and Washington to the south. But for the British, it would provide a place to land a huge invading army. If the British destroyed the capital and then captured Baltimore, they would gain an advantage. That's right, Grandfather Lafitte said. Capturing Baltimore was a key part of the British plan. From there, they hoped to attack other important cities. But I will tell you what actually happened. The Battle of Baltimore can be divided into two parts, the battle on land and the battles on the sea. The British general in charge of the attack on Washington, D.C., thought they could capture Baltimore as easily as they did the capital city. And that is not what happened, though, continued Grandfather Lafitte. The people of Baltimore knew the British were coming. They prepared themselves for a fight. A commander of the U.S. Army ordered that a huge earth banks called entrenchments be built along the eastern side of the city. They knew that the British soldiers would have to begin their attack there. Sure enough, one September morning, the British landed several thousand soldiers at a place called North Point. What is an entrenchment? Repeated Adele. Entrenchments are structures created to protect an area and the people in it. Entrenchments can be made by either digging into the ground or by building walls above ground. The entrenchments acted as a defensive wall and as a means of targeting the advancing army. In addition to building entrenchments, the army got ready to defend Fort McHenry. So this is an example of what an entrenchment could look like, digging it into the ground. Do you think building entrenchments was a good idea? Was the purpose of Fort McHenry to protect Baltimore's harbor? Asked JP. Yes, Fort McHenry was a defensive fort located right on the bay. It was built in the shape of a five-pointed star. The soldiers were perched on the tip of each star, pointed to protect the fort from all directions. The U.S. Army knew that they had to try to keep the British soldiers out, or they would surely lose. The British soldiers began to advance on the city. They kept coming until they were finally pushed back by a large U.S. Army. You can kind of see them here pushing them back. Did the British give up? Not yet, replied Grandfather Lafitte. They withdrew and set up camp. The next morning, the battle continued. The British marched right up to the entrenchments at North Point. This time, they didn't just face a larger U.S. Army, but lots of cannons and other weapons, too. The British quickly realized they were outgunned. They retreated, and we won the Battle of North Point. But what about Fort McHenry? That's quite a story, said Grandfather Lafitte. The people of Baltimore had imagined that they were in for a long, hard fight, and so they prepared for one. Besides building entrenchments, they stored supplies. They even sank some of their boats and ships so that the British were not able to sail into the harbor. They sank their own ships? Asked J.P., astonished. Yes, they did, explained Grandfather Lafitte. Another important part of the preparation included the creation of a new flag for Fort McHenry. The commander of the fort, George Armistead, wanted a flag so big that the British sailors would be able to see it from far away. A lady named Mary Pickersgill was asked to make the flag. What do you think the commander of Fort McHenry wanted the British to be able to see the flag from far away? I read a book about this once, said Adele. Mary Pickersgill needed help to make such a big flag. She did indeed, replied Grandfather Lafitte. Her daughter, her two nieces, and a young apprentice helped. The flag that these five women made had 15 stars and 15 stripes. When it was finished, the flag was as large as a house. It was actually bigger than the room they were making it in. Mary Pickersgill's flag measured 30 feet tall by 40 feet wide. Pretty much way bigger than our classroom, or close to even the size of our classroom. It was carried to the fort and would later be hung on a giant flagpole. Do you know how many stars and stripes the flag has now? There are 13 stripes and 50 stars, JP said. 13 stripes represent the 13 original colonies, and the stars represent the 50 states. Excellent, said Grandfather Lafitte. Now let's get back to the story. Before long, the British began firing rockets at Fort McHenry. At first, the British ships were too far from the fort for the U.S. soldiers to be able to return fire. For more than 24 hours, the British pounded the fort. For a whole day, with little return fire, the British ships sailed closer and closer to the fort. Once they were close enough, our soldiers were able to return fire. That must have sounded like a terrible thunderstorm. Probably louder than the fireworks on 4th of July, added JP. Did we hit any British ships? We sure did, said Grandfather Lafitte. In fact, the British ships were forced to pull back. They kept firing, though. However, early the next morning, the British realized that they had not been able to take over the city. They stopped the attack, and the British ships sailed away. During the night, the fort had flown a smaller flag, but as the British stopped firing and prepared to sail away, the commander, George Armistead, directed the army to raise the enormous flag that Mary Pickersgill and her helpers made. How do you think the soldiers in the fort felt as they raised the flag? Wow, exclaimed J.P. and Adele together. Grandfather Lafitte added, a man named Francis Scott Key watched the whole battle that night from a boat just outside of Baltimore Harbor. He saw bombs shooting through the air and watched the rockets rain down through the day and into the night. As the sun came up, Francis Scott Key was still on the boat. When he saw that enormous flag flying, he knew that Baltimore had been saved. The United States won the battle. Francis Scott Key wrote our national anthem, explained J.P. That's right. The events that morning inspired Francis Scott Key to write the poem that later became our national anthem. And so we'll listen to the national anthem. When the children were finished, Grandfather Lafitte smiled proudly to them. With his arms around their shoulders, he said, "Why don't we head back up to the house for a late afternoon snack? You might even hear about those pirates." "Sounds good to me." "Oh, pirates!" exclaimed J.P. Then together the three walked back towards the house. And let's look at our timeline. So we started with the War of 1812 starting. Then we moved to the Battle of Washington, D.C., where things didn't happen. But now, victory! The Battle of Baltimore. We had a huge victory against the British. Yay! So what inspired Francis Scott Key to write the Star-Spangled Banner? Again, the word inspired, I'll say the word, you repeat it after me, inspired. Inspired means cause someone to do or think something, especially to think something creative. My first grade teacher inspired me to want to be a teacher. Think of someone who has inspired you. And we're going to look at these and we're going to respond that if he or she was inspired, or he and she was not inspired. After going to the piano recital, Joshua wanted to learn to play the piano. He was inspired. After listening to the president's speech, my uncle wanted to be a politician. He was inspired. My older brother cleaned his room because my mother asked him to. Nah, he was not inspired. My grandmother went to college at night to earn her degree. Now my sister wants to go to college, too. She was inspired. After learning about Neil Armstrong, my cousin wanted to be an astronaut. He was inspired. All right, we have two more read-alouds left with the War of 1812. We're going to hear about the third part of the British attack.